Hi everyone and welcome to a new video. There has been a bit of time between this and my previous one, but as the days are getting very short now, it's hard to find time to do this during daylight. Nevertheless, I managed to find some time and today's video is about the Dell Optiplex 9020. In the video, I will completely disassemble the machine and then reassemble everything back together. After that, and if the PC still works of course, I'll run some basic benchmarks as well. If you're into this, make sure to subscribe to the channel. I've been using a Dell Optiplex 9020 in some of my previous videos, but for today's video I have a second one at hand. Somehow I really like the appearance of these small form factor Dell PCs. The design is nice and clean and the machine is not too big, not too small and has plenty of connectivity options. It can be used standing as if it would be a small tower or flat like a traditional desktop PC. The one which we will look into today still has its original 8GB of RAM, which I will upgrade with this 2x4GB kit during the reassembly. Before we open up the machine, let's check what there is to see on the outside. On the front side, we have the slim DVD drive, 4 USB ports, audio, and a power button. Then on the back of the machine, we have 2 PS2 ports, 2x display port, serial, VGA, 6 more USB ports, network, audio, and a power connector. To open up the PC, we can lift the lever on top and lift the cover. Inside, we can see the 225W power supply, the slim DVD drive with the SSD under there, and CPU cooler with the CPU under it. Let's start the disassembly by removing the drives. First up is the slim DVD drive. The SSD or hard disk is located in that blue drive bay under there. First, we need to release the metal frame that holds it and then we can lift it up. As you can see, all cables are pretty short, so we kind of need to disconnect the SSD while lifting it out halfway. That allows us to remove the metal cage which holds the blue drive bay which has the SSD in it. Doing so reveals the memory slots as well. We can see the 3 SATA boards here on the board. And power for the SATA drives is provided to the motherboard instead of directly from the power supply, using this kind of proprietary cable. Let me get the rest of smaller cables out as well. The built-in speaker first, then the front panel connectors. The power supply is connected with another custom or proprietary connector, and there is also a P4 connector closer to the CPU. To remove the fan in front of the case, we first have to remove the front panel using these 3 plastic clips. It's held in place with some flexible rubber standoffs which can just be bended to get a fan out of there. Next up is the plastic cover for the CPU cooler. This gives us access to more connectors like the intrusion detector switch and front audio. One more to go, the power button and LED connector. Now we can get the motherboard out of the case. First, we need to remove the 5 screws holding it to the case. We also need to remove the CPU cooler as it's fixed to the bottom of the case as well. And one more to remove is the standoff screw for the drive cage. As you can see, there is very little room to maneuver and it takes a bit of effort to get the mainboard out. Here we have a better look at the motherboard. Let me get that old thermal paste off the CPU first and do the same for the CPU heatsink. While we are here, I will also get the memory out. As mentioned, there was 2x4GB installed. Last component we can remove from the board is the CPU. An Intel Core i5-4590. As you can see, this 4th generation Core i5 is running at up to 3.7 GHz and has 4 cores. We'll see later in the benchmarks how well it performs with these specifications. Back to our Dell. As the mainboard is completely empty now, let's have a better look at it. We can see the CPU socket, 4 memory slots with order 1, 2, 3 and 4, a PCIe X1, PCIe X16, power connector, P4 connector and power out for SATA. Then we have the front audio connector, PC speaker, a connector for a regular speaker, power button and LED, CPU fan and intrusion detection. Here you can see everything nicely on the table before we start the reassembly. We have the motherboard, CPU and cooler, SSD and the drive bay for that SSD, case fan, DVD drive, the original 2x4GB of memory, and the memory to upgrade to a total of 16GB. Let's get those two modules out of the package and then we are ready to start the reassembly. First thing that I will put back is the CPU. To do so, we first need to open up the socket. Make sure the CPU is aligned correctly, just put it in and close. Next up is the memory. I'll start with the two new modules in a pair. Followed by the two original ones. There is no backplate under here for the CPU cooler, which means that for all the rest, we need to first put the mainboard back in the case. These 4 screw holes are lining up with those holes in the mainboard to fix the heatsink. As you noticed as well, while getting the board out, putting it back doesn't go very fluent either, as there is barely enough space for it. The board is back in place and we can fix it with those 5 screws. and that standoff screw for the drive cage. Then the CPU cooler, but first some fresh thermal paste. And we're good to fix that as well. Now we need to put back the smaller front panel connectors. Followed by all connections for power. And the case fan, of course. I'm not sure this is really the right method to do this, but it seems to be working, so I guess that's fine. Now that the fan is in there, we can put the cables for the drives back, both power and data. Everything is now connected to the motherboard, so we can put back that plastic cover around the CPU fan. All that's left are the SSD and DVD drive. Starting with the SSD, it needs to go in a frame that makes it as big as a 3.5-inch drive. Which then fits in the same blue colored bracket that will go in that metal cage eventually. If you would have a 3.5-inch drive, you can fit that directly in the second blue bracket instead. After fixing the SSD, we can put the two pieces together. As mentioned, the whole drive bay then goes into the metal bracket, which we need to fix with one side to the case first. And then, halfway in, we can put the cables back to the SSD. And fix the other side to that standoff screw which we put in earlier. This whole mechanism can be pretty confusing and you might need to start over if you didn't do this in the exact right order, since everything is a really tight fit. I can tell you that I've been there a few times. Next drive is the DVD drive, which you can just connect and then slide in from the back. All that's left now is the front cover. And then we can close up the case. All done. Time to test if the machine still works after what we did with it. I was pressing F12 to bring up the boot menu, and from that menu we can go to the BIOS setup. In system information, we can see our 16 GB of memory, consisting of the four 4 GB modules, our i5-4590, DVD and SSD. Exiting from the BIOS setup lets the system boot into Windows 11, which I installed earlier. Officially, this is not supported, but it runs just fine on here. If you're interested in knowing more on getting this installed on unsupported systems, I've put a card here for a video I did on that earlier. This brings us to the software part of the video. Let's start by having a look in Task Manager. We can see the same hardware here again, as we would expect. Let's start Geekbench and do a CPU benchmark. $2,950. Not too bad, not too spectacular. It doesn't make a lot of sense to test the onboard Intel HD graphics, so let's have a look at the SSD performance instead. That's definitely good enough for a fluent experience for daily tasks. As a last test, let me run Browser Bench, which I think is a representative test for this machine's expected type of workload. $128 is a pretty good result, confirming that this Dell Optiplex 9020, even if it's a few years old now, is an ideal, compact and silent machine for standard tasks and web browsing. Thanks a lot for watching this video. I hope you liked it, and if you did, please leave a thumbs up. If you like this kind of content, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel for more of the same. Thanks again, and I hope to see you back here soon.